Thank you. then I see everyone is fine, I guess. Everyone is fine. I'm well and life. It's been a lot, yes, but I'm still kicking and fresh. Nice to meet you again, friends. We're going to get our sing, our song, Open Our Eyes, Lord. Here we all stay.
Thank you. Father, we come before you today with grateful hearts, joyfully anticipating the blessing you have in store for us during this time of worship. Thank you for your deep and abiding love for us, for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself on the cross so that we may be reconciled to you. And so as we gather in this sacred place, we ask that you would fill us with your Spirit. Open our hearts to your word and help us to worship you in spirit and truth. Bless, Lord, our time together and unite us in your love. And we pray all these in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Can we have our song, Tell My People I Love Them?
Morning, our reading. Our first reading is from Acts 2, 42 to 47. It's headed the Fellowship of the Believers. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe. Many wonders and miracles, signs were done by the apostles. All believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave anyone as he needed. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God, enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their numbers. Daily, those were being saved. Our second reading, from Peter, 1 Peter 2, 19 to 25. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you received a beating for doing wrong and enduring it? But if you suffered for doing good and you endured it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we shall get our third and final reading in the Gospel of Jesus Christ according to St. John, the Gospel written by John, chapter is 10, and we start reading from verse 1 to verse 10. Then it reads as follows: the shepherd and his flock. I tell you the truth, the man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever come before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. This is the word of God. I'm struggling today, friends. I unfortunately broke my glasses. Cannot even tell you what happened, but I find myself in this situation. I have no glasses, so I can't see very well, but I'm trying my best. Hopefully by soon I'll get new ones. As you all know, I'm coming from the Eastern Cape in a very deep and rural context. Fortunately enough, at my place we have sheep, my grandfather's sheep. However, we struggled for years to get a good shepherd. Because in my place there are many thieves. People love stealing livestock, sorry. So we struggled for years to get a good shepherd. Because us as the children of a city family, we would go to school, so no one would look after the sheep of my grandfather. But fortunately, I think around 2009, we finally got a very good man who was from Lesotho. And Lesotho people trust me, they are so good with being shepherds. You would think that they go to a certain school to be nurtured to be good shepherds. And what they do is that from my own culture, we go behind the sheep when we are taking them to the field. And we call them by names if they do have names. But what they do, the Sotho people, they go before, not after. And then the sheep follows the shepherd. Yeah, it's a wow thing. It's a wow thing. I don't know how they do it, but all of them in my village, they do that. It's only us Xhosa people who go behind them. But all of them, they go in front of the sheep. So I asked this guy, can you give me your secret? How do you do this? And he said, you know, there's a certain flute they make a sound from their mouth that makes the sheep listen to them. I don't know how. I still cannot make that sound. Unfortunately, I've tried my best and I have failed in numerous times. So he trains me. And I try to imitate him. This other day, I'm standing in the field and the sheep are there. And I make the sound. Did these little sheep respond? Never. They just continued eating the grass. I was like, hey, this guy is one day going to go away with the sheep of my grandfather. I need to be close to him. And then he comes on the same day and he makes that sound. And guess what? The sheep just started following him. I'm like, something is wrong here. Something is wrong here. Friends, today we meet the Gospel of John. And John is placing us in a classroom where Jesus Christ is teaching of this powerful and profound message about the flock and the shepherd, and how the shepherd protects the flock. And in this passage, Jesus speaks of himself as the gate and the good shepherd. He tells us that anyone who enters through him will be saved and find pasture. He tells us that the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep, and that he knows his sheep and they know him. You know, friends, many a times we know God, but God does not know us. Not sure if you get that. Many a times we know God, but God does not know us. And this is caused by the fact that we only confess God. It is only a lip service, this thing of confessing our faith to God. But our actions make God to hide his face from us. But John is telling us that this is a two-way street. We need to know God, and God knows us. And the only way God can know us, it is only when we walk the talk. And these words are powerful because they offer us a clear picture of the kind of relationship that Jesus desires to have with us. He wants to be our gate. He wants to be our protection, our provider. He wants to lead us to green pastures and still waters, to guide us through the trials and tribulations of life. But he also tells us that he is willing to lay down his life for us. And this is an incredible act of love and sacrifice, and that it demonstrates the depth of his commitment to us. He is willing to give everything for our sake so that we might have life in abundance. And the question is, are we willing to give everything to him? Because he himself has offered his life so that we can have life abundantly. Mm-hmm. But then the question is, are we willing to give our lives to Jesus? Because it would be useless for him to be willing to give us his life, yet we do not want to give him our lives. Hence I am saying, it is very much possible that we can know God, but he does not know us. This is the two-way street. God has already given up his life so that you can have life abundantly. And the question is, are you willing to give up your own life so that you can have that life that he offers himself? And so, I ask myself a question, what does this being Christ's flock mean? It means that we must listen to his voice and follow him. And the reality, friends, is that we live in a world that is clouded by many voices. Some even claiming to be the voice of God. We are living in a world full of many teachings. Some even contradicting with what has been handed down to us in scripture. And the biggest question is, what do we do in such situations? And this passage of John then seeks to answer that question. Verse 5 says, the sheep know the shepherd's voice, and they will not follow the stranger. In fact, they run away because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. And ours then, it is to have the ability to listen to God's voice in this very noisy world. And we can only be able to listen to the voice of God in these many voices that are out there when we know God and God knows us. Because when he knows us and we know him, we will be able then to distinguish that this voice is the voice of God amongst the many voices. But if there is no relationship between you and God, you will be clouded by many voices and not be able to distinguish which voice of God is it amongst these voices. We know, friends, the teaching that are there out. We have a lot of heresies that teaches us that even God never existed. But ours is to always ask, is this voice from a person or is this voice from God? And if we are then his flocks, we are to have a relationship with God so that we can be able to recognize his voice. Because he can recognize his flock. And the responsibility of the flock is to recognize the voice of the shepherd. And that is why, friends, my Sotho friend there in the field, the sheep could respond to him. Because he had already established a relationship with the field, with the sheep. So it becomes easier to listen to his voice, even though I started with another voice. But the sheep never responded because they knew that this one is not our shepherd. But only responded when the true shepherd came. So it starts from building a relationship, then you'll be able to respond to a voice of the shepherd. Friends, you know, some of us here are married, some of us are in a relationship. If your partner is maybe in another room, when he or she talks, you can recognize that is my voice, that is the voice of my partner. You cannot mistake it with any voice, right? So it is that kind of a relationship that we need to have with Christ. That even when he speaks amongst many voices, we can be able to have a heart that discerns and say, that voice is the voice of God. And perhaps that is why John continues in his letter in 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 to verse 6. He says, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test these spirits to see whether or not they are coming from God. And therefore, friends, be assured that the shepherd is talking amongst these voices in this way. However, his voice needs one to have a spirit of discernment and be able to recognize his voice. And many people always ask themselves, We are having no shedding. We are having COVID-19. Where is the voice of God? And my answer today is, the voice is there. But it needs you to have a heart that descends and see God through COVID. You are alive. Now, a lot of people, you've been through COVID. And you should be asking yourself, what voice am I listening to? We have a lot of people that have lost their faith because of COVID-19. But you are sitting there and listening to that voice. Then it needs one to be able to recognize and discern. Because the voice is always there. And another thing that we do, we must trust in Him completely. That's what John says. And allow Him to lead us where He wills. We must also be willing to lay down our lives for Him, just as He has laid down His life for us. And trusting God completely and allowing Him to lead us where He wills entails a number of things, friends. And firstly, it means surrendering our own will and desiring God's will. And acknowledging that He knows what is best for us. It means be willing to let go of your own desires and own plans and trust in God's plans for your life because He knows better of your needs. And secondly, friends, it means having faith in God's goodness and love for us, even when we do not understand what He is doing or why He is allowing certain things to happen in our lives. Sometimes we do not need answers to the questions we have, but to just allow the will of God to take place in our lives. And I know humanly there are people who are always looking for answers. Why am I going through this? Why is my family going through this? Why? Sometimes you do not need answers. But to just allow the will of God to take place and you trust and commit yourself to God. And that is what John is trying to say us. He is the shepherd. Yours is to just trust and allow His will to take place. And then it means being obedient to God's command and guidance, even when it goes against our own desires and expectation of others. It means be willing to step out in faith, even when it is uncomfortable and risky. I don't know if you have ever been in a situation where you feel like the will of God is contradicting with my will. I want to go this way, but God is pointing me this way. But then, what is happening here, John is saying, we then must be able to allow God to take us wherever He wants to take us. Because when you do not want to be taken, you will want to be in charge of your life. And God will be watching. But God is saying to us today, allow Him to take over. And you just surrender. And lastly, it means being open to the leading of His Holy Spirit. And being willing to follow wherever He leads us. Therefore, trusting God completely and allowing Him to lead us where He wills is not always easy. Let us be honest, it is not easy. But it is essential if we want to live the abundant life that God has promised us. And the Gospel of John promises us that as we walk in faith and obedience, we can be sure of God that will protect and guide us. And after that, He will bless us abundantly. And He does not do this just for the sake of, I don't know how to put this, but He does this because He loves us unconditionally. That He even sacrificed Himself. And I was saying last week to other people, you know, God does not have time to think of how godly He is. God doesn't have that time of glorifying Himself. But what is always in the mind of God, it is His people. How can I help them? How can I protect them? How can I guide them? So that you, after receiving that, you can then give him glory, because he cannot glorify himself. So, today I want to tell you, you are his flock, and allow him to be your shepherd. Do not even try to shepherd your lives. Allow God to be his shepherd, and be like the sheep of my family who are just following behind the Sutumen, because they recognize that they are less than the shepherd. Then if you are less than the shepherd, then you follow behind. But if you are above than the shepherd, you will want to lead the shepherd. Then be like that sheep. And humble yourselves and let him to be your shepherd. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We have our offering.
Take all my soul, my dream, for my joy, every day, every night.
Friends, can we all say the benediction? Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
and the love of God,
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all.